Good afternoon. You're watching Nine News Now. I'm Amber Sherlock. Australia's worst serial killer, Ivan Milat, is back behind bars in Sydney this afternoon. Not long ago, we got the first glimpse of the terminally ill 74-year-old as he was transported back to jail from the Prince of Wales Hospital. Nine's Damien Ryan has more.
This could well be Ivan Milat's last moments in the outside world, transferred from a hospital to Sydney's Long Bay jail, looking frail and gaunt and every bit his 74 years. Milat was pushed or discharged from the Prince of Wales Hospital in a wheelchair, pushed by a nurse and surrounded by corrective services staff. He was then loaded into a four-wheel drive vehicle into the back seat. And then it was on for this 7-kilometre journey back to Long Bay Jail. Now, the authorities were taking no chances. Even once back inside, security was extremely tight. Milat shackled by the ankles and handcuffed as he shuffled his way back into what will be his new home, the hospital at Long Bay Jail. Of course, for the past two decades, he has spent his time in Goulburn Supermax Jail. Now, it is said that Milat is said to be riddled with cancer. Today, the prison's boss would not elaborate, only saying that he is in a secure environment.
If need be, we would upgrade its security as required. However, we're talking about a maximum security environment in any case.
Convicted of seven murders, and there may be some more cases. It's been reported that detectives would like to speak to Ivan Milat about some unsolved cases, but they may have to hurry. After what we saw today, it appears Ivan Milat's days may be numbered.
A horror collision has claimed the life of a mother and four children after a head-on crash northwest of Brisbane overnight. Nine's Alex Heineke joins us live. Good afternoon, Alex. How did this tragic accident happen?
Well, essentially, Amber, a small Nissan station wagon has tried to overtake a truck on a highway. It's gone onto the other side of the road, tried to make a pass, but quite simply, it hasn't made it. That station wagon, with five people inside, including a mother and four children under the age of 10, has collided with a road train at high speed. A very high impact crash, as you can understand, both vehicles heading in the opposite direction, and they both caught on fire on impact. The truck spewed to the side of the road and rolled over. The Nissan station wagon, it smashed into several pieces. The 35-year-old mother, three of her very own children were in that car. They died on the scene. But miraculously, a young girl, the other young girl, survived. She was taken by first responders to the Kingaroy Hospital and then whisked away in an emergency helicopter to Brisbane. Unfortunately, it was all in vain. She died in transport. Now, the 47-year-old driver of the truck that was heading in the wrong direction. Well, police say there was simply nothing he could do to avoid this crash, but miraculously, he survived as well. His truck, of course, caught on fire, rolled over to the side. He was lucky enough to crawl out of the cabin. He suffered burns to his hands, and he's also received some cuts to his head, but he is in a stable condition in hospital. Now, it's not just the family and friends of those involved feeling it today. You need to spare a thought for the paramedics and emergency responders that attended this truly horrible scene. Take a listen to what they said last night.
This is a catastrophic incident scene. It's certainly one of the worst accidents that I've ever seen. It's just a tragedy for everyone involved.
Now, Amber, that young family and that the family of that other girl that perished, they are from the Hervey Bay region here in Queensland. It's safe to say that community is in mourning, and as the rest of the state and probably the country as well, sending our prayers and thoughts to those involved.
We sure are, Alex. Thank you. The AFL community is in mourning after the death of Anna Green, the wife of former Melbourne captain Brad Green. The 40-year-old mother of two passed away yesterday after suffering cardiac arrest last week. Brad and Anna married in December 2013 after growing up in Tasmania. At least 15 schoolchildren have been stabbed, with at least one killed in a frenzied knife attack just south of Tokyo in Japan. The suspect, a man in his 50s, later stabbed himself in the neck and has since died. The motive for the attack is unclear. For the first time in 10 years, Sydneysiders will be forced to operate under water restrictions, and they've been brought forward, as Liz Daniels explains.
Sydney's not supposed to face formal water restrictions until Warragamba Dam level drops to 50%. That's not due to happen for another 6 to 8 weeks, but the state government has pulled the trigger early, meaning we will face level one water restrictions in Sydney from this Saturday. Now, those rules mean you can't use sprinklers, and if you do want to water lawns or gardens by hand, it has to be before 10 a.m. or after 4 p.m. in the cooler parts of the day. All hoses have to be fitted with a trigger nozzle, and we're being told not to hose hard surfaces to clean them, instead simply sweep them down. Water Minister Melinda Pavey says this is about making sure people are aware of how much water they're using as our dam levels drop.
We may get rain. The Bureau of Meteorology's predictions aren't fabulous, but as we know, as we plan weekends, they're not always right, and I hope that they are wrong. What goes up must come down, and I think that we are taking the appropriate course of action to take it to level one.
Penalties that will apply is $220 for individuals and $550 for businesses.
As you heard, those caught doing the wrong thing can be fined, but we're being offered a 3-month grace period to get used to these new restrictions. Sydney Water is also going to roll out a new advertising campaign to help people become more aware.
Disgraced rugby league star Ben Barber has been sentenced to 150 hours of community service after pleading guilty to 2 charges of public nuisance outside Townsville Casino. Police were called when the 29-year-old grabbed his partner around the throat, pinned her to the wall and hit her in the head with a shoe. She refused to make a complaint. Barber was also punished for obstructing police when they arrived at his home just 2 weeks ago to find him drunk and abusive. His lawyer told the court Barber is genuinely regretful and has suffered financially, with his $400,000 NRL contract ripped up as a result of his behaviour. Police believe biker gangs are behind a deadly shooting in Sydney's west. Craig Anderson was killed outside a home in Doonside at 7:30 last night. The 51-year-old shot 4 times in the stomach. An hour later, police moved in on the suspects, arresting 5 men during a vehicle stop in the nearby suburb of St Mary's.
This is a personal dispute. This is not a systemic, wider series of violence between bikies. This is a personal matter that has escalated and escalated unreasonably.
The 5 suspects remain in custody. Charges are yet to be laid. Friends of Courtney Heron have reportedly told police both she and her accused killer, Henry Hammond, were at a party just hours before she was bashed to death in a Melbourne park. It's understood the pair also left the event together on Saturday night. The 25-year-old's body was found behind logs in Parkville on Sunday morning. 27-year-old Hammond has been charged with her murder. The Prime Minister has warned coalition MPs and senators against complacency, despite the government's stunning win earlier this month. Let's head to Canberra. Political reporter Fiona Whelan joins us. Fia, big day for the re-elected government, but Scott Morrison wants focus.
Amber, it feels a lot like the first day back at school for the coalition. They've returned to Canberra for the first time since the election, and there are quite a few new faces in there. The Prime Minister Scott Morrison and the Deputy Prime Minister Michael McCormick welcomed the 28 new members and senators this afternoon. Some of them had their first class photo, although one new member isn't quite locked in yet. Counting is still going on in the seat of Macquarie, and the Savo Labor has edged back in front by about 27 votes. Earlier, Scott Morrison gathered his whole team in the party room and he congratulated them on their win, but he also paid tribute to those who didn't return.
Here we are, a fresh team. A team that is hungry, a team that is committed, a team that is united. But I want to thank all of those members who have served in this party room. I want to thank Tony Abbott for his service to our party and to our nation, who's no longer sitting in this party room for the first time in a very long time.
Now, once the cameras had left, Mr Morrison gave a bit of a friendly warning of sorts. He pointed out to his team that there was a wealth of talent in the room, saying that would keep the pressure on everyone to do well. Also under pressure now, of course, is Labor, who has to rebuild after their election wipeout. The new leader, Anthony Albanese, is going on a listening tour in Queensland this week to work out where the party went so wrong there. But he'll be back in Canberra later this week, and we should see all politicians back in Canberra in about a month, because the latest word is that Parliament will be back in the first week of July. Amber?
Fee, thank you. Slow down and don't drink and drive. That's the plea from police after four people were killed in crashes on Victorian roads in the space of a few hours. Lana Murphy reports.
Well, it was along this stretch of the Nepean Highway in Mount Eliza, southeast of Melbourne, where two people tragically lost their lives last night after the ute they were travelling in lost control, went across a median strip and slammed into an oncoming car. It was around 11:15 p.m. ambulances rushing to the scene as friends of the 22-year-old man and 18-year-old woman gathered in grief nearby.
Just too fast, lost control, spun out of control into the path of an oncoming car. Both those young people have lost their lives.
A man in his 30s from the second vehicle sustained chest injuries and was taken to the Alfred Hospital in a stable condition. Meanwhile, police are continuing to question a man who handed himself in after a woman's body was found in Ardeer, west of Melbourne. Police believe the female victim, aged in her 40s, was allegedly struck by a black Holden Commodore VT on Ballarat Road before her body was located around 7:40 p.m. An hour later, a 31-year-old man was killed when the car he was travelling in with two other friends crashed into a pole in Redcliffs near Mildura. The two other occupants were badly injured. One is fighting for life, the other serious, both at Mildura Base Hospital.
And one of those three mates has now lost their lives. That'll be an issue that impacts that family, his mates, and that town for some time in the future.
The four deaths bring the state's road toll to a 14-year high. 138 people have lost their lives on Victorian roads, 50 more than this time last year.